Martin, look at all of the people. Everyone is so excited. This is awesome.
All this fancy dancy equipment that didn't have my microphone plugged in yet. There we go.
Classic Martin.
Well, I don't know why they're so excited there, Katie. The stoic German Lutherans never get worked up about things like this.
Well, you know, there are a lot of Norwegians here, and you know those Norwegians, a pretty rowdy bunch.
I'll say, ufta. Come on now, ufta.
There we go. You know, if you think this is rowdy, you just wait until our next appearance at their Lutheran partner congregation in Colombia. And then Tanzania next month. This is quite tame in comparison. I mean, nobody's dancing. No drums, and no ufta.
Well, Katie, how about this? Ubuntu.
Ubuntu.
Ubuntu is Zulu for community. It means I'm a person through other people. My humanity is tied to yours. Ubuntu. I always love having scripture in the local language. It's great that these churches are partnering to share the gospel and learn new languages too. The Lutheran Church sure has changed in the last 504 years, Katie.
I know, isn't it great?
I'm not so sure. I mean, we never had guitars and drum sets and worship back in my day.
Well, you know, Martin, it's kind of hard to use instruments that haven't been invented yet. And there are definitely some changes to the way they worship, but there's a lot that's the same, Martin.
The Word of God, the Holy Supper, prayer, song, some things never change. And don't you dare change those things.
Shh, okay, calm down. Those things are all key. They're central, important in our faith and worship. They're not changing things just for the sake of change, Martin. All of the changes that they've made are to speak the Word of God in words and actions that relate to people today.
I guess that's true.
I mean, they're still using your small catechism. That's the central parts of faith right there.
I still maintain that is the best thing I've ever written.
You know, I bet a few of these confirmation students who've had to memorize it would disagree.
This is most certainly true.
You know, I think one of the biggest changes is these screens here. I mean, we could have never imagined something like this for worship.
I know. We thought the printing press was pretty advanced. Even with the printing presses, the Bible books and the books were rare. Imagine what I could have done with internet, with Twitter.
Oh, whoa, boy. That would have been dangerous.
I would be the king of Twitter.
Yeah, but not in a good way. Your name calling would get you kicked off in a big hurry.
Yeah, some things never change. People with thin skin not understanding my intellect and wit.
Some things never change. You not being able to admit and apologize when you've taken things too far.
Yes, I definitely angered a lot of people. I was never good at Minnesota nice. I really do deeply apologize for the things I've said and shouldn't have said, but it does my heart good to see the church growing. I mean, look at all these young people learning about God, and they'll be leading worship, proclaiming the gospel, memorizing my catechism.
Well, okay, you know, they don't actually memorize it anymore like they used to. It's not 1950 anymore.
What? Then how?
Okay, they still read it. They just don't memorize it. And definitely no more testing them publicly in front of the congregation. You of all people should appreciate that. No more forcing fear of God in the church, but focusing on learning scripture, on learning love and grace.
Oh, I do love to talk about grace. Grace. Everyone needs to hear the good news that God loves them and forgives them.
Exactly. And that's why it's so great that the church isn't done being reformed, even 500 plus years after your little temper tantrum with the hammer on the church door.
So what do you mean that the church is still being reformed? They didn't bring back indulgences,
did
they?
No. They wouldn't do that. I mean, the church isn't perfect by any means, but they're more open and welcoming than ever. They're learning about privilege and racism and inequality. They're trying new ways of being community and serving in the community. They've ended some programs that stopped holding meaning and started trying new things that are powerful and important.
And you forgot the most important one.
What's that?
Look, the most incredible and mind-blowing change of all. They're sitting in the front pew. Thank you, Katie.
The end.
Good morning. Welcome, everybody, to worship. A special good morning to the confirmation students who maybe had to set their alarms clock a little earlier, thanks to the choir. Today is Reformation Sunday.
You just made it sound like it was the choir's fault they had to get up early.
Oh, thanks to the choir for making these kids. So today is Reformation Sunday, and it's a great Sunday to think about in the church season. Because 504 years ago, so many things changed in the church for the better. And things changed in society and in music and in art and in politics. Martin Luther was part of that great Reformation. And as the skit said, you know, the church is still being reformed today as God continues to guide us and point us to his love, grace, and his word. So welcome, everybody. Thanks, confirmation students, for leading our service today. And now, we'll start with the invocation.
We worship as we live our lives. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
I didn't bring my thing.
Let's stand for the hymn, Gather Us In.
The Lord God has seen fit to call us together as the Church of Jesus Christ in this place. In our history of being God's people of Chapter Lutheran Church, God has given us the holy word of creation, redemption, and blessing. God has given us the holy word of forgiveness and grace. God has given us the holy word of guidance and mission, and sent the Holy Spirit to empower us for that mission.
And when we have strayed from the world, God has called us to return, that we might continue to be blessed by grace and favor. We are nothing without our God's word, hope, and promise. Therefore, people of God, on this day, I invite you to commit yourselves and your whole lives to God's holy word and to God's loving purpose. For you and us as Chatfield Lutheran Church, so that our lives may be enriched and the work of our hands blessed and prospered.
Let us pray, Almighty God, by your holy word. All that we know has come into existence, our universe, our world, our lives, our loved ones, and all that we have and hold so dear. By your holy word sent forth your Son to bring us salvation through the Christ of death and resurrection. By your holy word, you have called us together to be a church of love and service in the world. By your holy word, we know that we live in grace and hope to keep us ever so close to the world that it might be written upon our hearts.
We commit our lives to your word, O God.
Help us grow in faith and love toward you so that we might always live in trust and hope.
We commit our lives to your word, O God.
Center us in routines that keep us close to you, O Lord. Center us in weekly worship.
We commit our lives to your word, O Lord.
Center us in daily prayer.
We commit our lives to your word, O God.
Center us in knowledge of Holy Scripture.
We commit our lives to your word, O God.
Center us in the mission of the church.
We commit our lives to your word, O God.
Center us in lives of thankful giving and loving for all the blessings which you have bestowed upon us.
We commit our lives to your word, O God.
By your word, O God, guide us, guide our lives, forgive our sins, inspire our thoughts, shape our attitudes, lighten our darknesses, give us eternal hope, and fill our hearts with joy, assuring us of your constant presence until you bring us at last into glories of your heavenly kingdom. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen. Amen. You guys can be seated.
Almighty God, gracious Lord, we thank you that our Holy Spirit renews the church in every age. Pour out your Holy Spirit in our faithful people. Keep them steadfast in your word. Protect and comfort them in times of trial. Defend them against all enemies of the gospel, and bestow
on the church your saving peace
through Jesus Christ, our Savior and the Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Amen.
I invite the congregation to be seated, and we will sing Jesus Loves. You can still be seated, but the choir is going to sing before we do the kids' message. Thank you. Okay, now we will sing Jesus Loves Me, and the kids can come forward for the kids' message. Some of you big kids can come too if you want.
Loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong, they are weak, but he is strong. He
morning, everybody. How are you today? A lot of kids here today. Does anybody see all these big kids here too? The big kids are helping lead worship today, so they're going to do a lot of the parts of the service, and we're really excited about that. I want to tell you guys about a tradition that we had in my family. A tradition is something that you usually do over and over around the same time. So some people have different traditions at, like at Christmas or at different holidays or maybe birthdays. And in my family, we had a tradition that whenever we got together at my great-grandma Hahnemann's house, whenever we left my grandma's house, she lived on a block in the city, and so we would leave from the front of her house, and then we would drive around the backside, so everyone would wave to us at the front of her house, and then we would drive around the back, and everyone would run to the other side and wave to us over here, and then we'd go around the block again, and they'd wave to us over here, and we'd keep driving around the block, and we would wave, and we would wave, and we'd do it like 4 times, and it was so fun. As a kid, when someone else left, I got to go outside, and I got to wave, and then run over here, and then wave, and then run over here, and wave, and then when we left, we got to drive around, and we'd laugh, and sometimes we would drive the other direction around the circle, and it was so silly. And I loved this tradition, and it felt like this was a tradition that we always did, every time. Do you think that was something that always happened? When I remember, do you think there was a time that we didn't ever do that? Yeah, at some point, we started that tradition. It was something that was new that we hadn't always done. So today is a day called Reformation Sunday. And it's a day we think about traditions in the church. Because Martin Luther, you see this little statue of the guy right there? That's Martin Luther. 500 years ago, he made some big changes to the traditions of the church. And he said, we can do some things in a more helpful way for people who come to church. For example, they used to have all of their worship services in Latin. Do you know that? Does anybody speak Latin? Anybody? Anybody? Anybody speak Latin? Nobody here speaks Latin. And Martin Luther lived in Germany, and almost nobody there spoke Latin either, but they would go to church every Sunday, and they would hear it in Latin. So one of the things Martin Luther did is he says, we're going to have worship in the language that we speak. So they had worship in German. Does that make sense? Does it seem like a good idea to have worship in a language that you know how to speak? Yeah. But for Martin Luther's time, it was a big deal, and people got really mad about it. They said, this is our tradition. We always have worship in Latin. So it was hard for people to change those traditions. And traditions have continued to change throughout the church. There are things that it might seem like we do all the time, every Sunday here. But at some point, we didn't used to do that. You know, we had the choir sing just now. What was the choir wearing? Do you remember? Do you see some of them over here? What were they wearing? Were they wearing those blue robes? Does the choir always wear the blue robes? Usually, yeah. But at some point, we hadn't bought the robes yet. We didn't even have the choir robes. Maybe there were old choir robes, something different. So some of the changes that we make in the church to our traditions are kind of a little deal. It's not super important. They're just, you know, little things. But some of the things that we do in the church are a big deal. And so it's a big deal when we make changes to those traditions. Martin Luther made a lot of changes to traditions in the church 500 years ago, and we continue to make changes to try to grow and listen to God's word more and more every day. Will you guys pray with me? Dear God, thank you for traditions that teach us your word. Help us to keep changing, to be more loving toward you and everyone else. In Jesus' name, amen. Awesome. Thanks, you guys. You can head on back to your seats. We will hear the word of the Lord. The word of the Lord is going to be a little bit different today than you have gotten used to doing it in worship. Our confirmation students are going to do a skit for us. The skit is... Moses and Pharaoh and like the Israelites being set free from slavery in Egypt. So if you guys want to take your places, we'll have God over here on this microphone. Pharaoh will be here. Moses will be over here at the beginning. Israelites, if you guys want to come over this way, Pharaoh's army can maybe stay seated or over this way for the moment. There's a lot of moving parts here, so we got to get ourselves situated.
My people, and I will set you free. Moses?
Yes, God?
Go to Pharaoh and tell him to let the people go.
That's your plan? Just say, let them go?
Yeah, it's a good plan.
Okay, whatever you say, God. God says, let my people go.
No.
He said, no, now what?
Now I show them my power and might. A plague upon the people. No, 10 plagues upon the people. Then Pharaoh will let them go.
Okay, God, what will the plague be?
Well, the first plague will be the plague of blood.
Well, now will you let them go?
No. Then a plague of frogs.
Oh. Oh, now will you let them go?
No. Then a plague of frogs.
Now will you let them go? Oh. Now will you let them go?
No. Plague of gnats.
Now will you let them go?
No. A plague of flies.
Now will you let them go?
No.
Yeah, you're supposed to say yes.
Oh, yes.
Really?
No. Okay then, a plague on the livestock. A plague of boils.
Now will you let them go?
No. I have no choice but to send a plague of hail. And a plague of locusts. Then a plague of darkness.
Now will you let them go?
No.
Okay, Moses, this will be the last one, the biggest one. But you need to get the Israelites to protect themselves. This plague will kill the firstborn of every person and animal. If Israel wants to be protected, they must slaughter a lamb and paint the blood on the doorpost. Only a home with the blood of the lamb will be spared from the angel of death.
Ah, my son, you Israelites, your God has done this. Get out now before something even worse happens. Away, all of you.
Wait, where are we running to? Oh.
Wait a second. Why did I let them go? I need them to stay here as slaves. I'll send my army to bring them back.
I've got this. God has set us free. Praise to God Almighty. Alleluia. Amen. That was so
the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So Moses led the Israelites into a new way of being God's people together. In this new way of being God's people, they were no longer enslaved to Pharaoh. They were no longer enslaved to the Egypt way of seeking power and wealth and everything that went along with it. Then many hundreds of years later, Martin Luther led the church into a new way of being God's people. They were no longer subject to the power of the church, where the Pope and the people in power decided who would do what and who got God's love and freedom. Martin Luther led the people into a new way of having access to scripture in their language, to education about what it meant to be people of God. And now we today, we as God's people, are going together into a new way of being God's people. We don't have to be caught in the way we've always done it. You know, nothing is the same as it was 2.5 years ago. Everything has changed. And so we have this unique opportunity to be set free from the way things are supposed to be, and to discern and to listen and to figure out what God is calling us to and how what God is calling us to might be different from what used to be. We are going together into a new way of being God's people. Now, a new way of being God's people is hard. It is hard work. It is letting go of old things that we loved or things that were really comfortable and familiar. It's trying new things that might seem scary because we could fail. It is entirely possible. It was hard for Moses and the Israelites in the wilderness. Let me tell you, they complained a lot about everything going on. It was hard for Martin Luther and the church of the time. There was a lot of turmoil and change. And it is hard for us as well. But here's the thing, is that God went with the Israelites into the wilderness. They could see God's presence in fire and cloud. God taught them what it meant to be God's people together. God taught them through manna, through sharing, through being together, through prophets, through the Ten Commandments handed down on tablets from Mount Sinai. God went with them to help them figure out what it meant to be God's people. And God went with Martin Luther, too, into the difficulty of all of these changes in the world. God went with Martin Luther, not like physically visible in fire and cloud like with the Israelites, but God went with Martin Luther through inspiration and creativity and boldness to do the work that needed to be done at that time. And just like God went with those Israelites and God went with Martin Luther, God goes with us too, giving us what we need, teaching us how to be God's people, teaching us through scripture and worship, through community and prayer,
God goes with us, inspiring us with creativity and new ideas of how we can change this church and this world. God goes with us, coaxing us, encouraging us, pushing us sometimes to say, there is important work to be done. The way things always were isn't the way things always should be. God goes with us, forgiving us, letting us know that when you mess up, not if, when you mess up, I will still love you. I will still be here and support you and care for you. God goes with us every step of the way into the unknown, into the unfamiliar, because we are God's people. We are constantly being reformed and being remade in our church, in our community, in our world, and also in ourselves as human beings. We are made new in baptism each day. We are made new in God's love. We can take our sin and give it to God and be washed new, reformed as a new being. And the courage that we get from being made new in baptism every day sets us free to reform our lives, to reform our church and our community, to be more open to God's love and God's call to change, to love God's people as God calls us to do. So we are set free from everything that enslaves us, like the Israelites before us, like Martin Luther and the early church, like the early, the people who created this church 78-ish years ago. We are called to be God's people in a new way. So let's figure that out together. Amen. We will join together in our hymn of the day, the classic Reformation Sunday hymn, A Mighty Fortress Is Our God. So we will sing, what does it say in the bulletin? 1 through 3, thank you. I don't have that in here. Verses 1 through 3, so number 504. Let's sing.
Rooted in Christ and sustained by the Spirit, we offer our prayers for the church, the world, and all of creation. Please give us good weather for harvest season.
We pray for all the government leaders and their families.
I hope that everyone will treat our creation with respect and love. We thank the teachers and the school administrators for all their hard work.
We pray for the people that are struggling with mental health.
I pray for everyone who works in hospitals.
I pray that everyone dealing with war and conflict are okay and safe.
I pray that people who need healing receive what they need.
I pray that the military get more security after they serve.
Dear God, bless all the students in Sunday school.
Please make sure the elderly are okay and not lonely. Dear God, we pray for the ill to get better, especially for John, Deb, and Danny.
We pray for the family of Jim and Nancy Bowtecher on the death of his brother.
We pray for loved ones and care centers who are homebound.
Dear God, please help students get better grades.
We pray for those we name in our hearts. We lift these and all our prayers to you, O God, confident in the promise of your saving love. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
The peace of Christ will be shared with you always.
And also with you. We invite you to share a sign of Christ's peace with one another.
You may be seated for some announcements. Again, I want to thank the confirmation students for leading our worship service today on this Reformation Sunday. We have taken a break, just a one Sunday break from the story. Next Sunday, we'll continue with the story. Next Sunday is All Saints Sunday, where we'll be blessed by lighting candles and in memory of loved ones. And also, we will be going into chapter 8 of the story. We'll be looking at the judges, which is a very interesting part of our Bible. Holy Communion is today. We'll have a continuous fashion of serving. You can come up to the front. All are welcome. Two stations. If you want a gluten-free wafer or juice instead of the regular wafer and wine, please let the servers know. Trunk or treating is today at 4:30. That'll be fun for all ages. There's games, there's a bonfire, there's food, kids can come, and do we have some trunks that'll be open with the trick-or-treating?
Yes.
Yes, that's our hope.
That is our hope. Please come and do that.
You bet. Today at 4:30, after the Vikings' victory over the Cardinals. Adult Bible study is today between services.
Can I just clarify, we will still have it even if the Vikings don't have a victory?
That's heresy.
It's just calendar logistics.
Adult Bible study between services in the conference room on the book of Proverbs. Tuesday morning, I continue a Bible series called Martin Luther and the Reformation. You're invited to come. Congratulations go out to our volleyball and football teams for their wins this past week. Very exciting. Lefse making is coming up Thursday through Sunday. There's still places to sign up on the bulletin board out there. That'll be fun, especially when the bake sale rolls around here in a week and a half or so. At this time now, I'll call on Jeff DeBoer, our vice president of the council. Come on up, Jeff. He's going to give us an update, really an important update on our finances. Thank you, Jeff.
Good morning, everyone. As Pastor Paul mentioned, my name is Jeff DeBoer, and I'm here as a representative of the Executive Council here. to have the not-so-fun conversation to talk about the financial state of the church. It's never something that's real easy to talk about, but it is something that is important. We felt it was something we needed to address before the end of the year. As of October 1st, our giving amount was about $7,000 short of where our monthly giving, where our giving was last year at this point. And our year-to-date revenues versus expenditures is running about $44,000 short this year in comparison to our budget. This is a significant decline and obviously very concerning. As you recall, last year we functioned part of the year with only one pastor, and so this year our costs are up substantially there, and we had projected an increase in our giving with the lifting a lot of the COVID restrictions. This year, with not having any of those, we were expecting an improvement in our giving, and it has actually gone the opposite direction. As a council, we understand there's a reason for this. I mean, there's high inflation rates. It's hit a lot of families very hard. We understand that. And that's impacted how much can be given to the church. However, those same inflation rates have hit the church as well. Many of the bills have gone beyond budgeted expectations this year. So we're just very proud of what we're able to offer here at Chatfield Lutheran. We have free Sunday school, free confirmation, and we support many ministries that bring people to Christ. In fact, almost all of our ministries to children, teenagers, and families, materials, Bibles, these things are all free because of church offering. And we want to make sure we can continue to do these things and offer all these different things that we have in our church. We also have this beautiful new space that we've celebrated over the last few years, and our building renovation debt, just so you know, it costs about $5,220 a month is what our cost is for that, and we just need people to prayerfully consider stepping up their giving or making an end-of-year donation to help with the building loan. We are proud of our church building, but we face urgency in paying it off. One thing we know, we all love and are thankful for our new spaces. The bottom line is that this is your church. This is my church. This is our church. We ask you prayerfully consider your giving at this time. Are you being called to give more? We don't want anyone giving more than they can afford. As a congregation, we have always stepped up when needed, and I have no doubt that we can do the same now. And a little scripture to kind of connect to this is from Paul's second letter to the Corinthians. Each of you should give what you have decided in your heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. Thank you for your time this morning, and please take the opportunity to reflect on how you can help out your church. If you have questions about setting up a Simply Giving account, you can talk to Michelle in the church office or check out the newsletter on the monthly emails with information on how to enroll. And in writing this, this was not an easy thing to write. It's not an easy conversation to have with the church, but we just want to make sure everyone understands that giving to the church is an act of worship. All right, that is an important part of the act of worship. And we just ask people to pray, talk to God, and see what you can do to continue to support our church. Thank you.
Thank you, Jeff, for your service to our congregation and on the council. We will now receive today's offering. Please stand.
Blessed are you, O God, maker of all things. Through your goodness, you have blessed us with these gifts, ourselves, our time, and our possessions. Use us in what we have gathered in feeding the world with your love through the one who gave himself for Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Amen. We continue with our great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, Jesus took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." Now Aspen will lead us in the Lord's Prayer.
With these words, God wants to attract us so that we come to believe God is truly our Father, and we truly are God's children, in order that we may ask God boldly and with complete confidence, just as loving children ask their loving Father. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The table is ready. You may be seated. My confirmation assistants, if you'd like to come forward. There you go. Okay, come on back here, you guys. Okay, who's doing the bread on this side? The body of Christ given for you, okay? Please stand for the blessings. And now may the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his peace. Amen. And Lord God, we thank you for this gift of life. Lord, may we always be drawn closer to you. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. And now receive the benediction.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine upon you, shine on you and gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and to give peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen. Lift high the cross, a good Reformation hymn, verses 1 through 3.
Christ.